Thank you so much for joining us. We'd like to recognize for 5x15 at the Indian Summer Festival. Woo! That was really pathetic. Do it again. Louder! All right, well, you'll get better. We would like to recognize the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh nations on whose unceded traditional lands we live, work, and play. Welcome again to ISF 2015. Tonight's event would not be taking place without the support of many partners, patrons, staff, and volunteers. Staff and volunteers! Really. We'd like to thank our event partners, Creative BC, our presenting sponsor, the Canadian Institute for Studies in Publishing at SFU, the BC Arts Council, and our community partners, the Writers Fest and the Queer Film Festival. We'd also like to thank our festival partners, our premier partner, Simon Fraser University, the Georgia Strait, Spice Radio, and CBC. Tonight we're wrapping up the 5th annual Indian Summer Festival with our 2nd Vancouver edition of 5x15. And I'd really like to introduce our amazing host, who I feel was a gift to us from the universe, and also from Amber Dawn, who introduced us, the incredibly funny and wonderfully endearing Kalyani Pandya. Please give her a huge hand. Keep going, guys. That's really bad.
My gosh, look at all these beautiful faces. I am absolutely overwhelmed. Thank you so much, Indian Summerfest, for having me, for having all of us. Thank you. It's just absolutely great to be here. So, one of our first presenters, is Naresh Fernandes. And one of the things that his work reminds me of, for some reason, reminds me very much of my parents, very much of the music that they loved, and very much of first coming here, to Winnipeg, Manitoba, Canada, in 1970, I'm not going to say because I'll out my age, but I have to say that one of the things that fascinated me about coming to Manitoba, coming to Winnipeg, was beginning elementary school and having my realizing that suddenly I was placed in a very different reading program than the rest of my classmates. I said to my teacher, teacher, I'm just wondering, why am I in this room reading these books instead of in that room reading those books with all of my classmates? The teacher said, she looked down at her paper, she said, which one are you again? Which one are you? And I said, Kalyani Pandya. And she goes, oh, yes. And she looked down at the paper, and she said, Kalkina Pindaya. And I said, no, teacher, it's Kalyani Pandya. She looked down at the piece of paper and she tried again and she said, Kenia Pandya. Well, Kenia, you're in this class because you don't speak properly. And I just thought, oh no. I'm in a class to teach me how to read and speak, but the teacher doesn't know how to read or speak.
It's very hard.
I said, I am never getting out of this class.
It's very hard to describe the Indian
sound. Naresh Fernandes has done is he has given a soundtrack
to the memories of my parents' generation. He is an astonishing journalist, and he's very, very modest. So I will keep my comments brief. But he is a journalist who lives in Mumbai. He is the editor of Scroll In, a digital daily. He is consulting editor at National Geographic Traveler India. Previously, he was editor-in-chief of Time Out India. And he has worked at the Times of India and the Wall Street Journal in New York. He is also a Poesis Fellow at the Institute of Public Knowledge at New York University. And if that's not enough, he is on the editorial policy board of the World Policy Journal. The poet Rumi has written that in the House of Lovers, the music never stops. The walls are made of songs and the floor dances. With his latest work, Taj Mahal Foxtrot, he has given us the music of our lives that Rumi wrote of, where the floor dances. Please welcome incredible journalist and writer and speaker and presenter, Naresh Fernandes.
Thank you very much, Kalyani ji.
I'm a fan. I'm in my fandom.
Well, actually, I'm going to do, the music is my second presentation. My first one is about my journalism. Could we have the first slide, please? In the end, it all comes back to basics. Well, sort of. That's obvious to me as I'm churning out stories every day for Scroll.in, the digital publication I edit in Bombay, and read long discussions online about how journalism has changed. Of course it has, and then of course it hasn't. When I think about how journalism has changed and actually come full circle over the 25 years I've been a hack, I'm haunted by the trauma of how I ruined my best shirt at my first day at work. I had just turned 21 and had managed to wangle a trainee position at the Times of India, which is India's largest newspaper. I was issued an identity card, maybe next slide please, and showed up to work on the 1st of May 1990 in the smartest clothes I had. Bad idea. Maybe next slide please. Everybody in the newsroom seemed to take pride in dressing like a slob, it turned out. In the age before before TV, Indian journalists seemed almost to be participating in a contest to see who could wear the most ill-fitting clothes. Almost like a uniform, almost everybody was dressed in flappy kurtas or bush shirts. There was good reason for dressing this casually, as I discovered when I was conducted to the ground floor of the Times of India during my orientation tour. The Times of India is housed in an imposing black stone structure with ornate little domes in downtown Bombay, right opposite the famous Victoria Terminus railway station. In the 1990s, when I got there, the newspaper was still being printed in the ground floor of that building. Crowds of passers-by would gather on the pavement to gape at the whirling drums, noisily affixing ink to paper, and to watch the sheets being transformed into the next day's edition. The press was filled with a loud clatter. I leaned in close to inspect how the machines worked, and that's how I got a thick black smear of ink all over my nice white shirt. This incident has always reminded me for that just about as long as the news business has existed, creating journalism has always been a combination of craft and technology. The process would get a start when reporters typed out their stories. Could we have the next slide, please? And the instructions they got from the chief reporter would be not only about the content of the stories, but the length too. Give me 6 inches on the new nuclear reactor Canada is helping us build, he'd say, or 12 inches on the garbage problem. When you wrote out your stories, you knew that every 4 lines you typed out would make 4 column inches when the newspaper was printed. the technological aspect of the newspaper was even more pressing if you were a sub-editor, like I was, in which case your job involved laying out the stories to go to press. Could we have the next slide, please? Type was set into frames of a fixed size, so you needed to know exactly how many alphabets fit into each line. This was really important, especially if you were writing a headline. If you needed a larger headline that went all the way to the top of the page, it would take fewer alphabets. Each alphabet had a count. Skinny alphabets like I and J took a lower value. Fat capital letters like M and W took double the value. You wrote the headline on a piece of paper, and then you counted over each letter to see whether that brilliance of your thought would actually fit into the frame and make it to print. Since type was actually cast in a metal frame, there was no way to cheat. Either that brilliant thought fit or it didn't. Everybody wanted to be a master of the craft and create a headline just like this one. The guy who wrote this actually died 2 weeks ago, and it was sort of, and his death was mourned all over the journalism world. Economy and precision of language were also essential for another reason. If you were a correspondent posted away from the head office, you filed your story by telegram. Could we have the next slide? If any of you have ever actually used this machine, like I have, and they were used in India all the way up till last year, you know it's a notoriously unreliable machine. It could break down at any moment. And more than a century after the telegraph was invented, contemporary journalism continues to use a structure that has evolved because of the fickleness of this machine. In the classic newspaper story, what we call the lead, it contains all the essential elements you need to understand the situation. The five W's and the one H. The who, what, where, why, when, and how. If you sent off your stories with these elements and the bloody machine broke down after that, at least your reader would have an idea of what was happening. Every additional detail you sent after that was a bonus. This led to the birth of a very strange beast. In classic storytelling, you start at the beginning and you end at the end. Could we have the next slide, please? But in journalism, you give away the end. Could we have the next slide, please? And then you work your way to the top. Could we have the next slide? This is called the inverted pyramid. The base is at the top. Since journalists love to create mythologies about ourselves, we've created a whole series of stories about the telegraph machine and how creatively it's used. For instance, there's the one about how when Kennedy was assassinated, AP beat Reuters on the story because the AP guy saw it, ran to the telegraph machine, said Kennedy dead, and then pulled out his Gideon's Bible and told the telegram operator, and now send this. And the Reuters guy was behind him, but the telegraph machine was jammed. And so sort of he gave him two chapters of the Bible before he let Reuters break the story. Or so it is said. The telegraph also gave us a new set of conventions. Could we have the next slide? If possible, you tried not to use the word now. The next slide, please. Because the mistaken impression of a key could create a situation like this. Now would become not. By the 1960s, editors and some fancy schmancy journalists decided that the inverted pyramid was too old-fashioned for them. They decided to adopt the techniques of the novel to the realm of nonfiction. And they called what they called this new thing, they called new journalism, with a capital N and a capital J. This disease took a little while to spread around the world, but it got to India a few years ago. Now every 21-year-old job applicant I meet gives me a little sneer when I ask if they can write quick news stories, and tells me that what she really wants to do is long-form journalism, which is another name for this pathology. Long-form journalism is like that gym membership you have. Everybody claims to have one and know it's good for them, but very few people actually use it the way it's intended to. So everybody claims to read the great long-form journals of our time, but their circulation numbers, especially in India, prove that all these people are actually lying. And this brings me to the paradox of journalism on the web. The web has infinite space, so you can write as long as you want to without needing to count 4 inches to a line and try to fit all that type into a metal frame. That's exactly what started to happen about a decade ago, when every little girl who went out on a date came back and wrote a long blog post about it, and every ponytailed photographer who ate in a restaurant immediately posted excruciatingly, boringly descriptions of his saag paneer on his website. Most of that nonsense, thankfully, has stopped. And there's a good reason for it. A, these people have realized that even their best friends don't care for their navel gazing. And B, there's a good reason people read journalism created the old-fashioned way. And that's because it goes through a process of editing. In any professional newsroom, stories are discussed before they're written, the most relevant angles are found, and then the pieces are edited for clarity. The best journalism has always been a collaborative effort, not something produced by a fat chap padding around in his boxers in his bedroom. I'm being a little facetious here. The best long-form journalism can actually be thrilling to read and very informative. But very few people anywhere in the world have the ability to produce, to write this kind of thing. And very few organizations actually have the enormous resources it takes to produce this kind of journalism. But in addition, readers don't have the time to read 10,000 word stories every day. They want to know the basic stuff. The way they get their information now is what's changed the most since I started my career 25 years ago. Today, most people have got that first paragraph of the inverted pyramid, the who, what, where, why, when, and how, from Twitter and the TV news almost as soon as it's happened. For instance, not so long ago, Twitter and Facebook, Instagram and YouTube, maybe have the next slide, please, were crowded with photos and messages and videos from people in Baltimore in the US about the intense protests against police attitudes to African Americans. There was even a video showing the brutality of Freddie Gray being arrested, and it's clear from the images that excessive force was used. The next slide, please. Meanwhile, in Gaza, ordinary people were sending out photos that showed that the Israeli bombs last year weren't falling as precisely as the IDF claimed they were. There were dozens of children killed, and these bombs were destroying schools and hospitals. When these new platforms have given ordinary people the tools to disseminate another side of the story, this isn't without its pitfalls. To begin with, the people consuming this information, you, the readers, are often not very certain about the credibility of these items. In several instances, for instance, people with vested interests have attempted to create trouble by sending out pictures that aren't quite what they seem. Next one, please. Ever so often, this photograph crops up, purporting to show violence by Buddhist monks in Burma against Muslims there. As it turns out, it actually shows monks in Tibet helping the victims of an earthquake, but it could so easily be twisted. But also, this barrage of information presents another challenge. What does it actually mean? When you get updates every 30 seconds about a bomb blast here, a machine gun attack there, how do you make sense of it all? How do you understand what is significant? That's where professional journalists come back into the picture. To begin with, journalists are trained to be skeptical of sources of information. They're supposed to cross-check information to make sure it's accurate, and at least to try to understand the motivations of the sources who've released it. At the very least, if a story appears in a reputed publication, you know you aren't being sold a duck, well, most of the time. But mainly, journalists try to fit individual events into a larger framework, to try to explain what each small skirmish means in the context of a larger war, to show how this year's flood in Bangladesh is actually a sign of a more serious process of the long-term process of climate change. May we have the next slide? The person in Dhaka tweeting this waterlogged picture about the situation at the end of his street last week is unlikely to be able to put this in the context, in a global context. So in addition to the who, what, where, why, and how of a story, there's now a new element journalists must grapple with, the so what of a story. When my friend Samir Patel and I began to think about the character and mission of Scroll, the publication we run, we saw ourselves as participating in an exciting experiment. Never before had journalists had so much access to so much information from so many places so easily. But this has its hazards. With so much raw material available on the web, it's easy to believe that Facebook and Twitter are the entire world, to base your judgments on them and get a lot of information off them. That, we realized, would be lethal. The social media are often echo chambers where few opinions get repeated over and over again very loudly. To avoid this, we've spent a lot of money on very intensive reporting projects. For instance, just before India's elections got underway last year, one of our reporters got onto a train, may we have the next slide please, from Assam in the easternmost part of the country to start a 2-month journey that would take her 2,500 kilometers away to Kashmir. She spent that time talking to ordinary people about their expectations from their politicians and trying to understand what politics really meant to them on the day to day. We did another major election project to optimize the capabilities of the web. Maybe the next slide, please. We sent professional photographers around the country to capture the campaign with their cell phone cameras and to put their photos on Instagram. This literally shifted the frame of reference. They came back with powerful images, not just of politicians who were too far away to actually be captured by cell phone cameras, but of ordinary voters and what their hopes from their leaders were. In web journalism, speed is vital. And this, of course, is accompanied by its own set of problems. Far too often, the rush to be first with the story results in inaccuracies, which could seriously dent a publication's credibility. The urge to put out the story first also results in stories being shallow and lacking in nuance or context. We've realized that it's best to take a little time with a piece so that it's truly worth the time the reader decides to spend on it. The other challenge on the web is to resist the lure of the lowest common denominator. On my phone, I have a toolbar that shows me exactly what people are reading all the time. Now, it's very easy to become slave to those graphs. It's clear that no matter how high-minded Indian readers claim to be, the stories that get the highest number of hits are what we in the business call the ABC stories: astrology, Bollywood, and cricket. Ironically, some new internet technologies, especially Twitter, make us come full circle to the time that we counted alphabets to ensure that our headlines fit the number of columns they were supposed to. With only 140 characters to play around with, you have to use language as precisely and economically as those old-fashioned reporters and sub-editors in their flappy bush shirts did. You have to make sure that each word counts, or else you'll confuse your reader and lose their interest. All of this is a very long way of saying that the elements of journalism haven't actually changed in a century. But if you're a young person starting out in the profession today, you do have one big advantage. You could wear your best shirt to the office, and unless you spill coffee on it, you can be fairly certain you'll get home clean.
So much, Naresh. How much I wish my kindergarten teacher had known you. How much. So our next speaker is Meeru Dhalwala. And I couldn't help, unfortunately, but once again think of my mummy when I was reading about her. Because my mummy is a profound entrepreneur. She has a number of business ideas involving food. And one of them is, when she saw the book Chicken Soup for the Soul, she saw this book and she said, "Chicken soup for the soul? It looks like urine." Come on, Kalyani, let's write a book. Let's write our own book. We'll call it lentil soup for the soul and dhokra for the bowl. Because she's a very good guru. And of course, afterwards she said, I will do all publicity. I will do all publicity. We could go to Oprah. And then without missing a beat, she looks at me and she goes, probably you want to go to Ellen. Her other big business idea for the restaurant was based on the fact that she saw Chinese fortune cookies. And she said, look at this Kalyani fortune cookie. Fortune cookie. In our restaurant, we will do samosa karma. But I won't put any of this optimistic advice. This is much too hopeful. I think it's best to be honest. So when I open my samosa karma, I will put in there, only a fool would look for advice from a samosa. My mom would be absolutely thrilled to be here with Meeru Dhalwala today, because Meeru is actually living my mom's dream. Okay, so she was born in India and moved to Washington, D.C. at a very young age with her parents. And in D.C., she worked with various international nonprofit organizations on human rights and on economic development projects. She has an MSc, another one of my mother's dreams, for me, not for her. She has an MSc in development studies from Bath University in England. And she moved to Vancouver in February 1995 to join Vikram Vij. Now, we know that she has since been cooking and running the kitchen at Vijay's and Rangoli. Now, her restaurants have been hailed by the New York Times as, and I quote, easily among the finest Indian restaurants in the world. She and Vikram manage a staff of over 100 employees, and what is unique about this staff is that Meeru works closely with an all-female kitchen staff, all of whom come from villages in Punjab, India. They experiment with various cooking techniques and spice combinations, and Meeru is responsible for all of the recipes and all of those published in the books at Vijay's and at Rangoli restaurants. Speaking of her cookbooks, she has written two of them. One is Vijay's Elegant and Inspired Indian Cuisine. And this one won Cuisine Canada's 2007 Gold Award for Best Cookbook. Her second book, Vijay's at Home, Relax Honey, placed second in the Best Indian Cuisine Book in the World category at the 2010 Gourmand International World Cookbook Awards in Paris, France. Her ethic is a commitment to improving her business environmental footprint, most notably through her choices in produce, seafood, and meats. She sits on the board of directors for Vancouver Farmers Market and has developed close professional relationships with many BC farmers. Please welcome a new take on sustainable protein, very delectable, Meeru Dhalwala.
Before I get my mic, I'm just going to make one thing clear, that Kalyani made my life sound way more exciting than it actually is. Before I talk about, I'm a little awkward leaning over like this, but before I talk about what you see on the screen, I want to tell you why I'm standing up here and what got me to get on the stage and talk about this. Okay, now I'm on my element. When Sinesh asked me, do you want to come on 5x15 and, you know, if you want to talk about eating insects, and I was like, no, God, do you really think people want to hear about this? And all of us people out there, the few of us promoting, you know, insects as sustainable eating, you know, we've done our spiel, we've tried it, and people with money and those people eating out are just not catching on to it. And then I thought, but then exactly what I tell women in my restaurant is, you know, we can't just talk feminism and demand our rights as women, as equals, but when the going gets tough, we quit for our rights as women. So because the going is a little tough for our rights right here for sustainable eating, I'm not going to quit either. So I'm standing in front of you and I'm going to talk about crickets. Not just crickets, I'm going to talk about the whole idea of eating insects. When I was a girl, so growing up in Washington, D.C., I think all of us immigrants have a little bit of the same story. I've always grew up feeling like an outsider. You know, I mean, in my school, it was the black kids and the white kids and me right smack in the middle. And I was a tiny kid. And it was just, I always felt like an outsider. I always felt ignored. At home, I was an outsider between my mom and dad who were obsessed with each other. But I all deep down knew I was such an amazing person, but just no one really wanted to know what an amazing person I was. And I had ideas, and I read a lot, and I was being forced to be an introvert, whereas I was not really an introvert. I was a pretty big extrovert. And as I'm doing this, you know, sometimes a teacher would take pity on me, and it would piss me off because I would automatically think, without being this articulate, but I'm not a charity case. You know, I don't need for you to talk to me like this. I've got great ideas. I just don't have a format in which to, you know, even practice all of my ideas. And so, and you know, and again, this is all a life process, and I realize that, you know, I have to be in control of making this world a better place for me. And now, not other people, but it was a really big opening thing for me that, you know what, I'm in control of this world for me. Screw other people right now. I've got to focus on me. In order to make this world a better place for me, I do not want other people to be charitable with me. I want other people to participate with me. And so this is, again, leading up to me on stage right now is, you know, I want everybody for a minute to forget about this whole phrase about how do we make this world a better place for others, because that's such an intellectual concept. And talk about it, think about it for yourself, and then all of a sudden, you want to participate. We're selfish human beings in that way. You want to participate with yourself and make this world a better place for yourself. And, you know, the outsider business, it kind of got a little bit less and less as I got older and older. And then I landed in Vancouver, and the genocide in Rwanda had happened in April 1994. My agency where I worked, we had two offices in Kigali at the time, and we lost our office staff. The expatriates, the American expatriates were saved. But we lost our office staff, Tutsi and Hutu. And I just kind of thought, you know, this development business or this development work, I'm not in my element. You know, again, I'm an outsider. I'm not in control of making my world a better place. And so I landed in Vancouver, and the most magical thing happened. I landed in this restaurant that was 14 seats with really yucky, scrubby, yucky little carpets. And a man named Vikram Vich had lied to me over the telephone, and he said that he had just opened up a really nice Indian bistro. And I was like, oh, okay. And then the romance began, and I landed in Vancouver, and I was like, this thing sucks. And but it was 14 seats, and you know, beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and Vikram informed me that he kind of thought I sucked a little bit at the airport too when he met me. And I thought the restaurant kind of sucked with the walls and the carpets and everything. But I, for the first time in my life, I can say, I got in that kitchen and without realizing it, I felt I was in my inside. And as soon as I realized that I was in my inside, I was where I belonged. And I just learned through sense of smell that this is where I belong. Through my sense of seeing where I belong. Through my hands, this is where I belong. And from that platform is where I'm going to be leading you to here. So how do I do my job? How do I get things across? Number one, you walk into my restaurant and you need to visually see a beautiful restaurant. Simultaneously, while pleasing your eyes, you need to smell the restaurant. You need to be attracted with your eyes and your nose when you walk in. The food comes to you, and again, your eyes and your nose, and you're looking at the food, and it has to appeal to your senses. Then you eat the food. It pleases your palate. Once it goes down your palate, it doesn't end for me. I need to please it from the minute you walk into the door, and I'm not trying to be disgusting, and many of you know that I say this with pride. I have to please you from the minute you walk in the door to when it poops out of your butt. Because that is what food is all about. It's about what it's doing for all of our senses, and it's what it's doing for our body. Not only do I care about what it's doing to our individual bodies, I care what it's doing to the body of our planet. And the body of our planet is gonna be consisting of 9 billion human beings by the year 2050. And if every single one of us has my whole philosophy of life of how can I make this world a better place for me, we can't assume that we're allowed to eat all the meat we want in Canada, but they can't. Right? We can't assume that we can live in 5,000 square foot homes, but they can't. We can't make those assumptions of, you know, maybe we call it charitable, I don't know what it is, that, oh yes, intellectually we know what's going on, but emotionally we're just gonna do what we feel like doing. That's not the kind of world that I want to be a better place for me. So at the restaurant, it's like, okay, now, well, let's go from, you know, I didn't even realize in the beginning, I was serving yucky chicken for $5.99. I didn't realize antibiotics were a big deal. I did not realize that, you know, chicken feed is a big deal. Lamb, beef, all of this stuff, you only learn when your hands get into it, when you participate in what you're doing. So the same way, you know, I earn my living at a restaurant, I don't want you coming to my restaurant every day. I want you at home getting your hands in the food, because agriculture and what you eat is one of the most important things you can do to make this planet a better place. And so organic meat gets expensive. Natural meat gets expensive. Chicken gets expensive if it's all natural. And I'm not even sure for our bodies we need to be eating every single day that much meat. I'm not sure many of us really deep down, if you question it, feel good about killing the cow. I don't know if we feel good about, you know, rainforests are being destroyed for, you know, for the cows. And going back to 9 billion people, I'm sorry to all the vegans and the vegetarians out there. Our planet cannot even grow that much vegetables and lentils and chickpeas because we don't have the forest resources, we don't have the water resources. This is gonna have to be our future. And this is, I'm telling you, not as a statistician or anything like that, but this is my passion. And being an Indian restaurant, so it was about 2008, the confidence level was pretty cocky and high on my point of view, from me at this point. And I thought, okay, I'm ready to introduce insects on the menu. I had read an article in the New York Times in the magazine, and it was, I don't know if it was written by a guy named David Gracer or if it was on David Gracer, but it was the very first time I had heard about eating insects. Up until that point, I was one of those, oh my God, disgusting, there's a cricket in my shoe growing up in Virginia. If there was something green in my lettuce, I threw it across the kitchen and I would actually call up Vikram at the restaurant and say, there's a bug in the lettuce. I was a real wussy, sissy bug person. And I read about it and I thought, oh, that's kind of disgusting, but at the same time, environmentally, it's kind of cool. And then he talked about the crunch level, and then he's talking about, you know, worms tasting like grapes, and you know, mealworms tasting like this, and grasshoppers tasting like pistachios, and crickets and everything. And I was like, okay, and I'm reading it from a very intellectual level. And then at the very end, he had this one sentence, and it said, you know, if you look at it all holistically, eating insects for your body, for your personal body, and your planet is like riding a bicycle. Eating a 6-ounce beefsteak for your body and the planet is like driving the biggest SUV possible. And that to me was a very participatory sentence that so attracted me in terms of, okay, Meeru, you figured out what your next step is gonna be at the restaurant. So I got to the manager's meeting, and it's three guys and me, which is a problem sometimes. But we get there, and I announce that I'm going to serve crickets on the menu. And they just looked down, and I don't think they were listening, right? I think even somebody thought I was talking somehow about the sport, and I think Vikram said, well, you hate cricket. And I said, no, I'm going to serve the butt. I'm serving crickets on the menu. And no one really quite, and they're like, yes, there she goes again. All right, fine. I hadn't done enough research at this point, but I just made it clear I'm serving crickets on the menu. And then I got to work. I contacted David Gracer, And then he put me in touch with David George Gordon in Seattle. He was at University of Washington. And I started talking to him, but I got intellectually way ahead of myself emotionally. And we arranged a meeting. I tell everybody, you know, Vikram and Mike and Oz, you know, this insect chef is coming. We're going to meet with him on a Saturday. And up until then, like I said, I'm very intellectually into this thing. And then he shows up Saturday afternoon. This is 2008 we're talking about. Saturday afternoon, we sit on the round table at Vidge's, and he just takes out these boxes of all these live bugs. And that's when the emotional reality, and what I think maybe some of you are feeling when you're looking at the screen right now, just hit me, and I was like, oh my effing God, I can't do this. My heart sank. I was really, really grossed out. And there's a little white bug, you know, it's moving like this, and David says, eat it. And I suddenly thought, like, oh my gosh, am I like 10 on the playground all of a sudden? And all of the guys did act like they were 10 on the playground and grabbed the bugs. And they started eating them as like, ha, 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 ha. And I'm thinking, this is just so oafy, but I've got to do this because it was my idea. And now this is the other thing you do when you participate in life versus have a charitable attitude towards life, is you play games with yourself to participate. You play the weirdest mind games. And I compare it to what actors must do when they need to cry all of a sudden for a movie. Think of something horribly sad. And so in order to get myself to try the bugs, you have to understand these are unflavored bugs. I said, okay, God, I don't believe in you, but right now I'm going to. And if I eat these bugs, you're going to promise me that nothing bad is ever going to happen to my children. And so with that little thing, I went, I grabbed the bugs, and I just ate them. And the worm did taste like a little grape. And it was a live wax worm, and I was like, oh, if I didn't know it was a worm, and in my mind I'd closed my eyes and thought it was sushi, I would have enjoyed it. And then I knew I had to eat another worm, otherwise I'd be grossed out forever, so I grabbed another worm. The mealworms were a little weird. They're too fast. And then we had crickets and we had grasshoppers. I wouldn't say I enjoyed them very much necessarily, but then ask yourself, do you enjoy a piece of chicken breast that's just been cooked in nothing? No. And so I tasted the bugs, and then I got to work again, and that's when I realized that I don't have the time for every single one of my customers to have the reaction that I had to the crickets. So that's when I came up with the idea of grinding them up. So what I do right there is I order the crickets, and I roast them in a little bit of oil and cumin seed and a little bit of salt and red cayenne pepper. That is the smell, again, the attractive smell that's going to be coming out of my kitchen. Then I grind them up, and I mix them with cumin powder, more cumin powder, and I mix them with other spices, and I have my cricket masala right there. So that bowl right there, it's a little deceptive, has 100 crickets in it. And so, can we change the slide, please? That's the final product. Now, if I didn't tell you there were crickets in here, I don't think anybody here would be grossed out by what they saw. So what we need to get over is, can you go back to the previous one, please? We need to make that hump or jump or whatever you want to call it from that visual to the visual that I gave you. So that was in 2008, and it was a big deal in Vancouver that Vidge's was serving crickets. More importantly, I think it ruined my relationship with my in-laws forever. That as an Indian family in an Indian restaurant, I was going to be serving dirty, filthy, embarrassing bugs. The worst reaction I have had has been from the Indian community. I have received hate mail from Indians. I have received anti-Hindu, like, you know, you are not a Hindu, you are doing this. The Indians have been mortified that for a while, you know, you had this great Indian restaurant called Vidge's that was bringing, you know, Indian food to the limelight, you know, an Indian couple, Indian this, Indian, 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 India. And then suddenly, you know, I completely humiliate the food and the culture by putting these disgusting things on my menu. I had an email, I think, a letter saying, what are you going to do next, serve Haitian mud on your menu? And that to me was just a racist comment. I couldn't believe it. But it hurts your feelings. And the newspapers loved me. The magazines loved me. I became so popular. It was the first time in my life I became popular, actually. And but they did not in the end. These did not become popular. People talked about it, but again, people were being too intellectual about sustainable eating. People were being too intellectual about climate change. People were being too, let's entertain ourselves and have fun at this restaurant, but let's not go any deeper than that. So people who did order it fear factory, like, you know, oh, let me impress my girlfriend by eating this. Or, you know, it wasn't a big enough change. I kept it on the menu for 2 years, and then 2010 happens, the Vancouver Olympics are coming here. I'd just taken them off the menu, and man, did so many Asians come to Vidges to try the cricket dish, and I had taken it off the menu. And that leads me to the next thing. 80% of this world's population eats bugs, eats insects. We are the 20% that does not, the Europeans and the Indians. But Indians do, it's just, I don't think it's a popular thing to do in India. And so how do we take that 80% to the 20%? What does that mean? Like, why is it that we don't eat them? You know, one of the theories is that, well, Europe had plenty of animals. That you know, Europe did not have to resort to eating bugs. Resort, not resort, the point is, European taste buds and Indian taste buds are gonna have to change. What we need to do is look at that. Crickets are arthropods. Grasshoppers are arthropods. That's the exact same family as your prawn, as your crab, as your lobster. The vitamins are huge in here. Protein, iron, zinc, a lot of protein actually. Omega oils, really high in omega oils, the crickets are. I'm gonna just, you know, go back to one other thing. Their poop is clean. And I spend a lot of time, I'm an Indian, you know, you grow up with the, you know, your health is determined by those four words, by the quality of those four words. They have very, very high quality poop. And when I was doing the crickets, you know, I had an issue, like, you know, we're sitting here, I've got 0 minutes left, okay. You know, we're sitting here, we're cleaning them, and I talked to the entomologist at UBC, and he told me that they have a totally different digestive system, and that the insect feces actually is full of acidophilus and bifidus. And because their digestive systems are completely different than ours, we don't even risk any sort of like swine flu type of diseases or anything like that. There's gonna be no disease transfer between the species. And so it's a perfect, perfect food for us. We just need to participate in this food and figure out how to make it taste good the way we've made crabs and lobsters taste good. Crabs and lobsters eat junk at the bottom of the ocean. Bugs eat flowers, they eat trees, they eat fruit, they kind of eat nature. And so we've got to make that change. It's going to be slow, but I'm hoping that you guys go away from here thinking, all right, how do we participate in our lives for yourselves to make this world a better place? And I gotta take one more minute, I'm sorry. Last night, I went to see Jeans and Jazz at the Vancouver Playhouse. It was absolutely amazing. And Harold and his son Jacob had done a thing on, you know, jeans and cancer and jazz. And Harold, Harold is a Nobel Prize winning scientist, doctor, and he does his work on cancer. And I was talking to him last night at the very end of it, and I was telling him, oh, I'm giving a presentation on crickets, why? I talked about, you know, I'm a little obsessed with climate change right now. I'm not sure what to do. And then he said to me, he says, you know, if I were to do it all over again, I would focus my science on climate change. He said, cancer is not gonna kill us, climate change is gonna kill us. And so to hear that from him, and then I went and I did a little Wikipedia search later on that night on him. He got rejected from Harvard University twice. And then he gets the Nobel Prize. So no matter how often I get rejected by these bugs, at some point, hopefully, I'm gonna win the food equivalent of the Nobel Prize for insects. Thank you very much, everybody.
my God, Meera, you have succeeded Meera in doing the impossible. You've turned my natural chi 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 to, oh my God, that looks delicious. One of the things that was talked about earlier this evening was that we are visitors on territory, the Kosil Squamish, and I was at a conference this week, the Canadian Aboriginal AIDS Conference, where I really learned a tremendous amount about the importance of acknowledging ourselves as visitors and of really knowing what that means, that we are both visitors on these lands and we work here, we live here, but we're ultimately being hosted here. And one of the things that my father was always tremendously aware about, tremendously, and really tried to make that point to me, was that it is extremely important for South Asian people to be aware of how connected our fates are with Aboriginal, Indigenous people. Because as my father said to me many times, you know what? They were looking for us. About it. Columbus stumbled here. They were coming for us. He was also very, very particular about my sensitivity to language. And I'm talking since I was five, since I began to even open a book. He was really fond of giving me logic puzzles, and everything was an opportunity for this logic puzzle. One day, he saw something in a magazine, and he called me over, and he said, hey, come here, take a look at this. Look what it says. You give a man a fish, he eats for one day. You teach a man to fish, he eats for the rest of his life. Now tell me, what is wrong with this statement?
I don't know. Papa, I don't know.
Okay, this is logical for everybody except the white man. He will eat his fish, your fish, my fish, her fish, their fish, children's fish, grandchildren's fish, grandchildren's children's fish. They will eat whole ocean of fish. Now, what is moral of this story?
Eat more vegetables.
No, that is the minor moral. The major moral is, choose your words very carefully. And don't teach white people anything. Our next speaker is quite possibly one of the most amazing people I have ever had the fortune to meet. We are about to hear from Dr. Patrick Stewart. No, not the captain of the Enterprise. Someone far better. Dr. Stewart is a member of the Killer Whale House of the Dakhan of the Niska Nation. His Niska name, Lukikyo, means fish already in the creek. He is an architect with 20 years of experience operating his own firm, Patrick R. Stewart Architect, in the Stakhlo traditional territory. Patrick was the first architect of First Nations ancestry in BC to own and operate an architectural firm in BC, and the first person of First Nations ancestry to be elected president of the Architectural Institute of British Columbia. His dissertation has recently been quite well profiled. He is famous for writing a dissertation without any grammatical punctuation. and it has been featured in the National Post, Vancouver Sun, Montreal Gazette, Calgary Herald, Saskatoon Star Phoenix, Regina Leader Post, Time Magazine Online, USA Today, let's not forget Gawker.com, MSN, and the New York Times Online. He participated in the award-winning film documentary, Something to Eat, A Place to Sleep, and Someone Who Gives a Damn, a film on homelessness. He was featured in the winning film documentary, an architectural film called Aboriginal Architecture, Living Architecture. He is chair of the Provincial Aboriginal Homelessness Committee. He lives on the Tikiaktan First Nation, along with his wife, fashion designer Linda Lavallee, whose boots are amazing. You have to look at them. And together, they have a blended family of 7 children. Welcome someone better than the captain of the Enterprise, Dr. Patrick Stewart.
I'm afraid I'm going to disappoint everybody after I start talking after that introduction. Thank you very much. So we get Sigram Hana, who am Garam Mugasam, Lugiat Thwai, Niskani, Wubdakani, Kikingol. Good evening, everyone. And I'd like to thank Suresh for the invitation to come and speak tonight, and thank everyone for coming tonight. I was asked to speak on grammatical resistance, whatever that is, but my dissertation did get a bit of media attention, which was quite a surprise to me, and it wasn't planned, it wasn't anything that I did. It was a friend of a friend of a friend kind of thing, and next thing I know it took off. So, grammatical resistance. Really what I was looking at was the idea of resistance and using grammar as a vehicle. And that's sort of how I look at it. Next slide, please. So this is the style that I was writing. And these are some of the words that I just said. So I said, Simigigat, Sigram Hanak, and that's, and it's in my dissertation, that's how I begin the dissertation, and that's the way I was taught to introduce myself, and so when I'm speaking, and so I just took it to the page, and I said to the audience that read my dissertation that this is the way I'll present myself in the pages as if I'm speaking. And so I've taken that idea sort of from cover to cover with some compromises. The university was not 100% okay with the idea. I had to make some compromises. Abstracts International, for example, wouldn't allow it, so I had to do it in academic conventional English and, you know, the title page and a few other accessories. But from page 1 to 149, it is the way that I wanted to write it. And it is without much in the way of punctuation. I do use some conventions in there, although I don't use periods and commas, capital letters, that kind of thing. Next slide, please. So one of the questions that I asked myself about grammar, And this is sort of a condensed version of what I was thinking. In school, I felt I was always judged harshly in public school, and I never felt comfortable with all the rules. To me, it seemed so abstract. I would always ask questions one of my problems that I ask too many questions, but it's like, explain to me why I have to do it this way. And the answer always came back is because this is the way we're taught. This is what the textbook says, this is what you have to do. You indent your paragraphs, you don't, you know, all the rest of it. And it never seemed to make much sense. And that was always a bit of a struggle. And one of the things in approaching the dissertation was thinking one thing. Here I am, I'm in university, I am a student. I should be able to explore. I should be able to do things that are not necessarily conventional. I should be able to test ideas. I should be able to question things. And that was one of the things that sort of drove me in terms of my writing. I had a very supportive committee, and my wife is here, and I would complain to her, and I'd say, they don't stop me. They don't ask me any questions. They just say, great work. And it's like, after doing all the work, I was a bit apprehensive submitting my dissertation because it was like, I was walking off a cliff because I didn't know if this was going to get accepted. There were a few road bumps in the journey, but it wasn't quite as easy as that. Next slide, please. So what I wanted to do, in terms of challenging, I guess, the status quo or what the rules said that you had to do to submit your dissertation, I read it really well so that I understood all the rules so I could break them. And I could do it in between. I did it in places where there weren't any guidelines. Nobody said you had to capitalize. Nobody said you had to use periods. And it doesn't say that when you look at the dissertation formatting. So I complied with the dissertation formatting. And my dissertation, this is the kind of document it is. And it has everything. It has the table of contents. It has the order that you need to put it in and all that kind of stuff. So they could not just throw it out. That was a risk. And my committee was very clear that as I proceed with this, that I am taking a risk. Behavioral Ethics Research Board refused my application the first time and the second time. And I wrote in this format. And they suggested I hire an editor and learn how to write English because they couldn't read this. And my supervisor, Dr. Michael Marker, he said, what are the idiots? And he tried to explain to them. I wrote letters to them. And we organized a meeting. And we went, and they said, okay. The chair said, okay, come on down to our meeting, and we'll bring you in. You complete your case to the board. Great. So we were there at 8:30. I live in Chilliwack. It was a bit of a drive early in the morning, but I got there. They left us sitting out in the hallway like two bad school kids in two chairs outside a closed door for an hour. And because we were supposed to be there at 8:30 and we were. At 9:30 he comes out, the chair comes out and said, no, we're not going to meet with you. The board has decided no. And that was it. So they refused my application. Not once did they talk about the substantive issues of my dissertation, my research, any of that. Was not an issue. They didn't address it. All they had a problem with that style of writing, was no periods, no capitals, and they couldn't handle it. So my committee and I, we had a meeting and said, okay, which battle are we gonna try? One of my committee members suggested, we don't really need the ethics board approval to go do research. You take a big risk, though, that the university, when you go to submit your dissertation, there's a little box that says, have you got Research Ethics Board approval, yes or no. And if you put no, then they're going to haul you in and wonder why not. So we had to decide what battles to fight. I'm the one that just said, okay, I'm not going to take this on, because it delayed me like 6 months in my research waiting for this Ethics Board process. So I said, okay, I'm just going to do what they want. So I took my application, did it in conventional academic English. Within a week, I was approved. Not once was there a comment on any of my substantive issues. It was just all totally about the writing, which infuriated me more, and I wrote about it in my dissertation. And that was one of the ways to sort of speak back to the university. And when I went to submit my dissertation, you have to have graduate, the Faculty of Graduate and Postdoctoral Studies approval to submit for formatting. And those are the really, hopefully there's nobody here from there, but those, they're really the police. And, you know, they look at every little detail in the document. And because it came in basically cold, it sort of went up the food chain really fast and went to the associate dean. And they don't typically read dissertations. But he did, and then he phoned me, and he said, we need to meet. And so it's like, oh, great. So I took the chair of my committee, because I wasn't going to go by myself, and we went and had a meeting. And he was very good. He was very gracious. He wanted to support it. He really did. The head of formatting was there, and she was great. She said, my staff was so excited to see this come in, because this is something different, and it was really good to read. And the dean, of course, he couldn't just follow along. He had to put his two cents in. And he said, and I wrote about him in my dissertation as well, because I got to do revisions after he talked. And he said, I struggled through this. And I think the word he used was slogged. I slogged my way through this. And I had followed the formatting requirements of doing a glossary, because I use a lot of NISCOT in the dissertation. And I did a glossary, which is what you're required to do. And then I proceeded to write the dissertation, but I didn't translate anything else throughout that. So he said, here he was with the glossary at the front, and every couple pages he'd be flipping back. He says, I wanted to rip that glossary right out of the dissertation, so I had it with me. And he said, could you be sympathetic to the reader? And I said, what do you mean? And he said, well, can you translate every word of NISCOT into English? And my chair said, no, it's too much. And I said, yeah, I could do that. I said, it wouldn't take long. And I got his point. And if it would make it just go through, I thought I could do that. So I did. But then, that's where the grammar police come in. The people that are sorted down the food chain, they got hold of this thing when it came back in. And they said, yeah, but you know, we want English first. We don't want NISCA first. We want English. And I was like, crap. That's not the way I wrote it. I wrote NISCA first, everywhere. And they said, no, it's not going to work. We're not going to accept it. So I said, okay, well, how about a compromise? So we haggled with it, and the preliminary pages in the dissertation, table of contents, preface, that kind of stuff, I said, okay, I'll put English first in there with a NISCA translation. But in the body, from page 1 to 149, it's NISCA first. And they hummed and hawed and said, okay. So I got that through. The dean came back and said, okay, it's unconventional, but UBC is supposed to have a new relationship with First Nations, so let's give it a go. So, okay, but it was still a risk, because this thing still had to go through external. I had to do my oral. And next... So when I was writing this, and so this created a bit of a challenge, because this is supposed to be a doctoral dissertation. This is supposed to be sort of, you know, the nth degree of academia, I guess. But I inserted myself into the dissertation because, as the previous speaker talked about, this was about me. This was my chance. This was my story. This was what I wanted to pursue. And doing this dissertation, I got 2 minutes, okay, thank you. I mean, the whole intent of the dissertation as an architect, I was writing this to look at the use of indigenous knowledge or traditional knowledge in design, because I was getting all kinds of feedback from clients, from elders, from communities that I worked with, and you know, most of my work is with First Nations communities or organizations. I was getting feedback that the designs somehow needed to have a little bit of work. I didn't like the color because it reminded me of residential school. I didn't like the materials because it reminded me of residential school. I didn't like the massing because it reminded me of residential school. After a few years of this, I thought, hey, there's something here. There's definitely a reaction to sort of the colonizing world. And here I'm coming along offering a little bit something different and saying, what is it you want to do? What were your traditional forms? What were your traditional artwork? How can we sort of infuse the culture into these designs? And so they just said, okay, let's do some of this. So I used a lot of concrete kind of, you know, concrete poetry mechanisms in my dissertation. So there weren't any comments on this. People didn't know how to, my reviewers did not know what to do with this. Next slide. And this is a cedar log. That cedar log, it sits on my front porch at home, but it was a log out of one of the columns in one of my projects. And I thought, hey, let's use this in the dissertation. And yeah, it turned out to be very powerful. Next slide, please. So that picture didn't turn out so good on the right. But it's a curved hallway, and so when you're reading the dissertation, one of the sentences is curved like that and says walking down a curved hallway. And I inserted project information in there that talks substantively to the culture. And you know, this is a fireplace rock naming out in Seabird Island. We didn't have the money, the community didn't have the money to actually put a fireplace in, but all the rocks traditionally were named. And so we thought, okay, they got a pile of marble, as it turned out, and we cut them into tiles, and they laid them out the way they would traditionally, and this is in the lobby, and they use it as a fireplace. They sit around it. You can walk in there, and there's elders sitting around, they're chatting, and it's a conversation kind of focal point in the building, in the lobby. Next slide. And I inserted poetry in the dissertation. Thoughts that I've had growing up. I was born homeless. My mom was homeless. And I grew up as a foster kid. And that was one of the big drivers, too, of wanting to become, I guess, an architect. Ever since I was five, I didn't know what architecture was, but I knew I liked buildings. And I would walk when I was five. It was a different time then. I could walk by myself. And I would go and I'd explore and I'd go look at buildings. And they just sort of kept pulling me. School wasn't quite so friendly and I struggled to get through school. But that's just another talk and another time. But I was really appreciative of being able to write the way that what I was trying to convey was being able to write as if I was speaking. And at my defense, one of the university examiners, his Sim Shan, anthropologist at UBC, and he said, you know, when I read your dissertation, I could hear my grandfather speaking in the longhouse. And I'm out of time. So thanks very much.
I'm speechless, which is a bad thing for a comedian and an emcee, but thank you so much, Patrick. Astonishing. Our next speaker is Jagdeep Singh Mangat. And he also has something very much in common with my family's hopes and dreams. He's a lawyer, like my father. My father always taught me to be very careful with words, right? So one day, he saw me with a little card in my hand. I could not have been more than 7. And he said to me, what is that? Bring that here. Bring that here. And so I brought it there. And he looked at it. It was just a little pink construction paper heart with some lace stapled, glued around it. I had made a Valentine for the boy next door whom I adored. Kevin Wright. My dad looked at it and he goes, "What? You can't give this. Why are you giving this to Kevin? You're giving this to Kevin. You can't give this to Kevin." I said, but why not? I love him. My dad said, "Think. Use your head. You've put, my heart is yours. He will see this as organ donor contract." How many times have I told you, think. Think what white people have done to the people they only thought were Indian. You are an Indian. He will take your heart right out of your chest. And he was actually training me to take over his firm, and he did this. He took the card and he wrote in it, "To Kevin Wright, currently residing at 301 Lamont Boulevard, Winnipeg, Manitoba. My heart is yours, where heart is defined in Appendix A. Article 1.1 to 1.17. This document does not represent any true or accurate representation of any organ, human or otherwise. Now you can give it to a white boy." Jagdeep Singh Mangat is definitely every father's dream in terms of his work and also in terms of who he is. You are far too modest in your bio. He is a family and immigration lawyer, and he is passionate and works for the rights of low-wage workers. He is involved in many social justice campaigns and organizations. And he is on the board of directors of a number of societies. One of the things he did not put in his bio is that Jagdeep is actively engaging in what I think is a process of transformation just by being who he is. Because for some of us, we have had terms of definition assigned to us rather than terms that we come up for ourselves. And I feel as though you, Jagdeep, with the work that you are doing, are really, I would think, an activist, an artist, and an advocate in the best sense of the word. Please help me welcome Jagdeep Singh Mangat.
Good evening. Thank you for the organizers of the Indian Summer Festival here. Thank you all for giving me the honor of taking a little bit of your time to share some of my thoughts on the on a pretty topical issue, I guess, not only you know, in our community at large, or in all basically modern sort of urban centers, but also, I guess, particularly you know, within the South Asian community here in the Greater Vancouver area. And I guess you know, the topic here is you know, dealing with gangs and criminal business organizations. So just a word before I sort of launch into, you know, my two bits. I have a concussion, okay, and it's this is unscripted. So if I you know, suddenly zone out for a minute or two, just bear with me, please. Okay. So I'll give you a little bit of a background, I guess, just in terms of you know, my expertise, where you know, in terms of what qualifies me to speak on this topic here. One, I guess the starting point today is this: I am a lawyer. I do family and immigration law. I've got a significant component to my practice, which also encompasses social justice work. I do a lot of pro bono work with people here down on the downtown east side here, as well as low wage workers. You know, I live a pretty good life. It's a pretty decent life. You know, it's not, I guess, relative to where I've been, it's not all that exciting. You know, I like it. It's a decent, good, honorable life. So with that sort of, you know, introduction, I'll go into a little bit about my past here. My parents came here in 1969. My parents didn't really want to come here. They were quite happy in India. Both my parents had a, well, you know, a love marriage. You know, they met at Punjab University in Chandigarh. Both of them met at law school and, you know, ultimately got married. My mother was a Dalit, Shadud caste. She was a Majbi Sikh. My father was from the Jat caste. And ultimately, they decided to get married. That didn't go over too well with their family. Well, predominantly with my father's Jat family. And that and a number of other things, you know, ultimately led them to basically flee India and come here. My dad, when he realized that, you know, he was going to be killed, basically sat down and said, well, you know, how do we get the first flight out of here, and, you know, where should I go? And he talked to a couple of his classmates, and they sat down and they said, well, Narendra went to some place called Vancouver, right? Where's Vancouver? Right? They were like, oh, it's in Canada, right? So my dad was like, lend me some money. I'm catching the next flight. And anyways, he ended up here back in Vancouver back in September of 1969. My mother followed him the next year. You know, she was put into hiding, my older sister as well. I came along in 1973. So I'm born and raised in Vancouver. My parents settled down on the east side. That's a really big deal for us, especially for me. I'm an East Vancouver boy, and you know, that's a you know, big sort of badge of honor that sort of we wear, and that's sort of perhaps one of the ways I primarily identify myself. Now, with that said, you know, East Vancouver back at that time, I mean, it was a very different place than it is today. I'd say, you know, largely that, you know, and this is a whole different topic, I guess, it's leading it all to other stuff. East Vancouver at that time was very much a very working class immigrant neighborhood. You know, it was a white working class, it was the immigrants. You know, Vancouver was a city that was sort of, you know, by design. When the CP Railway laid out the city back in, you know, the 1880s, it was sort of a model city of the future, right? Now, you know, back in those days, they had this notion that, well, you know, the working class would sit on that side, would be on the east side of the city, and sort of the managerial and upper classes would be on the west side of the city, and you'd have this class-divided city. And really, that sort of defined very much the character of this city. And when we're talking about gangs, and particularly gangs in Vancouver, I think that's a really important thing to sort of understand, to sort of, you know, to get an idea in terms of where we're at in this particular context today. Particularly when we're talking about South Asian gangs, that's sort of part of the fabric that sort of, you know, woven in there, the historical context. So they came here, you know, and during the 70s, 60s and 70s, I mean, you know, there's going to be people in this room that remember those days. There was maybe 5,000-6,000 people in the South Asian community in all of British Columbia. That was it. It was a very small community. It was very sort of, I wouldn't call it a very, it was a confident community, but it wasn't, I'd say, institutionally immature community, not the way that it is today. I mean, today you can sit down, you can do your banking in Hindi or Punjabi, you know, you could do, you know, go to your doctor, you don't have to speak a word of English. Back in those days, I mean, it was a very different city. It was also a very working class, tough community. It was full of people that were berry pickers, you know, janitors. The biggest thing was, you know, if you had a job at the lumber mill, you know, how many people know what the green chain is? Anybody here? Right? And I mean, yeah, there's some arms up here, right? I mean, that's a really big deal, right? The green chain, when you're working out of a law mill, right? I mean, you know, at the sawmill. And, you know, back in those days, if you're a South Asian person, Punjabi person predominantly, that was the vast majority, you know, Punjabis and Indo-Fijians, I mean, everybody knew what the green chain was. The women knew what the green chain was. The men knew what the green chain was. The green chain, basically, on the lumber mill. You worked the green chain. Oh, so-and-so got their arm ripped off by the green chain when they were putting up a piece of lumber through. Right? I mean, to rip your arm off. It was a piece of machinery, basically, that sort of, you know, was, you know, basically, it was sort of the assembly line of the, you know, on in the lumber mills there. So that was sort of, you know, the milieu that we sort of grew up in. Very tough, blue-collar, gritty, working-class city, you know what I mean? With trucks and, you know, guys with, you know, Mack jackets and storm riders and whatnot else. And it was quite common to be called Hindu and, you know, Paki and all the rest of that. You know, you'd show up at school and you were ready to fight, basically. Every day, you're ready to go, right? Like, let's, you know, it's go time. So, I guess when we look at sort of gangs today in the greater Vancouver area, really the gang phenomenon really here in greater Vancouver, it's a very unique and sort of anomalous gang phenomenon in terms of North America. I'll get to that perhaps if time permits in a little bit. But really the modern sort of, you know, what we see today in terms of, you know, the gang scene that's going on in greater Vancouver area here really started in earnest in the 1980s, in the mid-1980s. And, you know, it's a really complex sort of long sort of explanation in and of itself. But essentially what you had was very much sort of American-style sort of street gangs at that time, with identifiable colors, geographical areas, and it was very much isolated, not to, you know, where we hear today, like Surrey and Abbotsford and all the rest. It was very much isolated to East Vancouver, the working class part of the city. When you looked at places like out in Surrey and whatnot else, I mean, that was Redneckville, right? I mean, right, that was, right? Very homogenous for white and, you know, areas, you know, outside of Vancouver, really. I mean, Vancouver, East Vancouver in particular, was were sort of the white working class, the hard scrabble, you know, immigrants and whatnot else. You know, this is where we were, and it was in that milieu where we had organized crime that basically set up proxy wars. You know, I mean, different organized crime factions, like true criminal business organizations that basically had their street gangs sort of fighting proxy wars. You know, I guess a good analogy would be something like the Cold War, you know, where you had the Soviet Union, the United States. They had proxy armies all over the world basically fighting a live war, you know, on the ground in El Salvador and Congo, you name it, Vietnam, Korea, on every, you know, part of this planet here. So that really was what sort of the gangs came out of. They were formed to fight these proxy wars between different criminal organizations. You know, the traditional Caucasian organized crime, as well as the different Chinese tribes that were coming in at that time. You also had crack coming in. This is like the mid-1980s. Crack was a big phenomenon. You also had China White, which was basically pure, heroin coming in from the Golden Triangle. And so there was a challenging, particularly with the triads moving in, the Chinese triads that were moving in from Southeast Asia. you know, the one of the bit of the piece of the pie. So that's where we saw sort of the beginning of the sort of the entire, you know, the formation of gangs here in Greater Vancouver. Anyways, I found myself in that milieu, basically in the, you know, mid-80s. By that point, my parents, you know, marriage had sort of broken down. And, you know, if you were in East Vancouver at that time, I mean, you know, you just couldn't avoid street gangs. They were everywhere. A very different city than it is today. The murder rates were higher. We hear today about all sorts of, you know, dramatic incidents of shootings and this and that. I mean, it pales in comparison to what was happening at that time. I mean, it was very normalized at that time, really. You know, they also closed down Riverview. You'd get 500-600, you know, overdose deaths a year, 700-800. That was fairly common back in the 80s and 90s, right? But anyway, so that's sort of where my background is. Let's take a little bit of a switch, if I could sort of change tack here very quickly. What are gangs, right? We've got like this perception that gangs are, you know, kids in puppy jackets, you know, hanging out at, you know, in front of the 7-Eleven at 3 o'clock in the morning smoking cigarettes, right? You know, it's sort of this nebulous sort of, you know, term. Oh, that guy's like, oh, I wonder if they're on a gang, right? But really, I mean, you know, I guess, you know, this is sort of a topic in sort of academia. Oh, 5 minutes. Jeez, 10 minutes already. Anyways, this is a bit of a topic here in academia here in terms of, like, the definition of gangs. I mean, I think that's a very simple, you know, definition. If you get, like, two or three more people that are operating in tandem together, you know, for some type of an economic gain. And I think that's really what the key is. It's some type of an economic gain. You know, you have basically what we could call loosely, you know, a gang or basically a criminal or business organization. Really, they're criminal business organizations. You cannot understand a gang unless you understand sort of the economic, you know, the economic motivations for it. We're talking about drugs, prostitution. You're basically talking about commodities, right? An underground economy that deals in basically provides, you know, meets the demand, basically supply, in terms of meets the demand for all sorts of illicit products, which for one reason or another have been, you know, legalized or regulated. Predominantly that's drugs, right? That's the vast majority. But I mean, it could be anything. It could be counterfeit t-shirts. It could be stolen cars that, you know, have their vehicle identification number, like, you know, swept out. And, you know, it could be anything. You know, it could be human beings. So I think, you know, geez, time passes so fast when you're out there. You need to think, oh, you got 15 minutes. Wow. But I guess I'm going to move forward a little bit here. I think, you know, one of the things is this. I was on a panel a number of years ago, and that panel, you know, they had a question, right? There's myself, there's the attorney general at the time, there was, you know, the head of the coordinated forces law enforcement unit, which is basically the gang unit here in British Columbia. There was a professor of SFU, he's considered a international specialist in gangs and whatnot else. I was the last speaker, and the question that was put to the panel was this, well, how do you get rid of gangs? And so, you know, the attorney general went up, blah, 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 just didn't really answer the question. You know, the international expert, you know, I mean, at SFU went up and, you know, blah, 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 didn't answer the question. Like, he just didn't answer the question. You know, the head of the CFSU went up, blah, 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 didn't answer the question, right? And it was just, you know, I was sort of skirting the question. The question's a simple question. He says, the lawyer coming out at me, like, answer the goddamn question. What's the question? Answer it. And so they put the question to me, and, you know, how do we get rid of gangs? And it was very simple. I sat down and said, well, we'll never get rid of them, period. You're just not going to get rid of them. It's just not going to happen, period. Gangs are a part of, I'll say it, they're a part of a capitalist society. Okay? They are a part of a capitalist society. There's a fellow by the name of Dr. Bruce Alexander. There's, you know, a fair amount of research. Let's just look at just drugs, for instance. When you live in a commodity-based society, we have the commodification of labor and the alienation of one human being from another. Capitalist society gives rise to the products that gangs supply. Let's look at drugs, for instance. Let's look at just the work of Dr. Bruce Alexander. And I highly encourage you to sort of, to do some research if you have any interest in this. Dr. Alexander, he's done his extensive work on this topic and basically documents how addiction has not really been a problem until we've got capitalist society. You've got a society which basically commodifies human labor power. Oh, I see the big zero here. Commodifies human labor power, basically, and operates by individualizing people and automatizing people. And when we break down the social bonds that bind us, when we break down that sense of community, when we sit down and individualize ourselves, when we have something, the concept of homo economicus, the homo economicus, the human being at the center of capitalist society, the society that we live in, this automaton that only interacts with other human beings for individual self-gain, that profoundly alienates people. And there's something that militates against who we are. It gets rid of the notion of love, compassion, empathy. And that's sort of the society that, this is the conceptualization of the human being of the type of society that we live in. When you have a society that is built upon that notion of the human being, and that's how we're expected to sort of act, and it pushes us to act on person. I mean, there's no, I would posit, like Dr. Alexander, I agree with him, that you're obviously gonna have a society of profoundly alienated people and the attendant problems that has. And drugs, or addiction to gambling, or all sorts of alcohol, or all sorts of other things are just gonna be basically fixes that happen. You know what I mean? That sort of can mask, medicate, if you will, that pain that comes out of there. And when we have, who's going to sit down and provide the remedy to it? I mean, I guess, gangs are. But anyways, this is a huge, it's a huge topic. 15 minutes. Yeah, maybe some other time. Sit down and have a beer with me afterwards. We'll medicate together. Who knows? Anyways, I'll leave it at that.
Lawyer too, and it always makes me think of that old line that our parents always say whenever they disapprove of something we do. I didn't come to this country so you could. Dot 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 dot. When my mother found out that I wanted to be a comedian, she said that exact thing to me. She said, I know you're going to talk about me, okay? And I know it's going to be all lies. We didn't come to this country so you could talk about, vagina on stage and bring shame to the whole family. You're going to talk about your vagina? And I said, oh my God, this is where the misunderstanding is. I said, of course I'm not going to talk about my vagina. I said, Ma, I'm going to talk about yours. Mine? What's wrong with mine? I said, nothing. And she said, look, I have children, okay? My vagina is productive. Yours, just for show. And I thought to myself, you're damn right it's just for show, and what a show it is. Show it is? I said, if my vagina were a meal, it would be a 7-course meal. You would need a sommelier to tell you what wines to have with my vagina.
She goes, okay, so that's what it is, huh? You've come to this country to shame the family and to talk about vagina on stage. And I said, you know, Ma, that's the other source of our misunderstanding. You didn't check my application for immigration. Because I did write on there purpose of application to shame the family and to talk about vagina on stage. One of the people who has made me so comfortable with my sexuality, my body, my identity, and a person who has given us exquisite words, beautiful writing, a real wordsmith, is our final speaker for this evening. She is Amber Dawn. And she is not only an astonishing writer, and I'll get to her bio, but she is also an amazing agent. She got me this job. And she hired me at her film festival, at the Queer International Film Festival here. She took a chance on me. She hadn't even seen me. She rolled the dice and took a chance on me. I am so lucky to consider her a friend. And one of the words that Jagdeep used, he talked about compassion, he talked about love, he talked about wisdom, connection. These are all things that any one of you will experience reading this person's work and experiencing this person's performances and readings. Amber Dawn, this is also totally insufficient, is a writer living on unceded territory of the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh First Nations. Her memoir, How Poetry Saved My Life, a hustler's memoir, won the 2013 Vancouver Book Award. She is the author of the Lambda award-winning novel, Sub Rosa. She edited the anthologies, Fist of the Spider Women, Fear and Queer Desire, and With a Rogue Tongue. Amber Dawn was 2012 winner of the Writers' Trust of Canada Dane Ogilvie Prize for LGBT writers. She currently teaches creative writing at Douglas College and at the University of British Columbia. She volunteers and mentors at several community-driven art and healing spaces. Ladies and gentlemen, and everything in between, Amber Dawn.
Easy work to be listeners. And so here's what I want you to do to get this started. Turn to the person or people beside you and say, my goodness, you look fantastic tonight and you're a really good listener. Commence. Did it feel good? It felt good, didn't it? Yeah, we should be complimenting each other. Tonight is a night of much gratitude. It is. It's fantastic. This is fantastic. Keep calm and write poetry. This internet meme is the first thing that I show my students when we begin our poetry writing unit. At the University of British Columbia, my Introduction to Creative Writing course is a 3-month course. In that time, we cover fiction, nonfiction, writing for screen and television, children's literature, YA, graphic form, which is comic books, songwriting, and poetry. Most of my students want to write fantasy novels or Hollywood film scripts. Beginning the poetry unit never fails to cause just a little bit of apprehension and animosity. Oh, next slide, please. This can be my symbol for next slide. So next, I might torment them a little bit by reading them the work of the famous American modernist William Carlos William. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow, glazed with rainwater, beside the white chickens. I ask my students to raise their hand if they are familiar with this poem. I will ask you to do the same. Raise your hand if you are familiar with this particular poem. Mm-hmm. Most of my students remember the Red Wheelbarrow from high school. I then ask them to raise their hand if they never actually understood the point of this poem. I'm going to ask you to do the same. Raise your hand if you've never actually made a connection with this particular poem. Honesty. I like it. My questions get a little bit more challenging. I ask my students if, in fact, they kind of hated studying poetry in high school. A discouraging number raise their hands. Some of them even need to disclose negative personal experiences, struggling to write a Shakespearean sonnet or haiku for a school assignment. It's almost as if studying poetry in high school was some kind of trauma that they are still in recovery from. This is the point that I have to work back from to teach my poetry unit. In my early 20s, which is the average age of my current students today, I also had some obstacles to poetry. I have a learning disability. I grew up poor. I am a survivor of childhood trauma. I have a criminal record. At the time, I was working street-based sex work, and I had a somewhat unmanageable relationship with drugs and alcohol. I was living just two blocks from here in an SRO on Carroll and Hastings. This is primarily how this neighborhood is thought of. It's a place of vulnerable women, especially Aboriginal women, a place where colonial violence is enacted every single day. May we always remember the truth of this and the work that we need to be doing to create solidarity with this neighborhood. Thank you. I will also join you for a beer to talk about what we could be doing, if that's appropriate for you. Let us also recognize that the downtown east side is a neighborhood of poetry. Now here I want to mention activist and poet Bud Osborne Rest in Power, Thursday's writing collective that draws tens upon hundreds of poets to the Carnegie Community Center on Main and Hastings, the annual Heart of the City Festival, 12 years running, and the reputable publication Megaphone Magazine, shown here. You've likely met some of Megaphone street vendors, excuse me, in neighborhoods across Vancouver. So just by living in this neighborhood, I was exposed to poetry. There's many ways that we could appreciate the robust and diverse poetry of the downtown east side. For right now, so we only have 15 minutes, as you've learned, I'll say that here, poetry is used as a means to resist erasure. It's poetry of memory, of visibility, and creating dignity and survival. I'd like you to meet one of my favorite local poets, Muriel Marjorie, and here's a quote from one of her poems. I've not actually seen it written down before, I've only heard her present it out loud. I'll read it how I remember her reading it. I live off memory. It's memories that keep me sane. So Muriel Marjorie exemplifies poetry as a means of resisting erasure. This photo of her was taken from the annual Heart of the City Festival. Her on the megaphone, to me, really nods to this powerful oral tradition, or the spoken word tradition that she primarily works in. So like Muriel, I started with an oral tradition. I had discovered a few open mics around East Vancouver where I started to read my new poems to audiences. This began my connection to poetry. Then in the summer of 1998, I had secured myself a sugar daddy. This is a client who picked me up in a champagne-colored Mercedes-Benz, and he paid me enough to send me to my first class at the University of British Columbia. I decided to enroll in Introduction to Writing Poetry. Kate Braid was UBC's summer poetry instructor. She's a carpenter by trade and a poet by heart, and I liked her immediately. Just look at her beaming eyes, those strong arms, what's not to like? Kate Braid told her students that if we wanted to truly know poetry, then we must read poetry books, cover to cover, hopefully many poetry books. This is what poets do, they read. It had never occurred to me that I could walk into a bookstore and buy a published book of poems. So I set off to the People's Co-op Bookstore and Commercial Drive in my quest to truly know poetry. The first collection I purchased was PK Page's Hologram, a book of glosses. This is a wonderful book, and it just celebrated its 6th print run. I highly recommend it. I didn't know what a glossa form of poems was, but something in me lit up when I read the foreword, in which PK Page likens her process of writing the glossa to birds that learn to sing by listening to the notes and cadences of other birds so they can blend it into their own call. PK Page wrote, quote, "We have a song of a kind, but it's not until we have heard many other songs that we are able to put together our own specific song." Well, this alone was compelling enough for me to buy the book. Also, I suspected that if I returned to class with a book of form poetry, my classmates would think I was really smart. I imagine my classmates thinking, "Wow, that little runt from Hastings Street reads form poetry?" And indeed, the glossa is very impressive. So first used in 13th century Spain, the glossa poem begins with a source quatrain. Now that is four lines from an existing poem by another writer, followed by four stanzas of 10 lines. The last line of each stanza is taken sequentially from the opening quatrain. Do you got it? I'm going to read you one later, so don't worry if you don't have it. It took me a while to catch this form as well. PK Page, of course, the enactment of this form is gobsmackingly fine, as she works quatrains by canonical poets such as Rilke, Sappho, Elizabeth Bishop, Dylan Thomas, and Pablo Neruda. Again, I had never read any of these poets. My experience with poetry was all spoken word, not textbook. So in this way, PK Page... her glosses introduced me not only to her own writing, but it also gave me a little bit of an in to experience writing of poets from a canon that had previously eluded me. Many years later, I now teach PK Page and the glossa form to my students. Let me tell you, the glossa goes over a lot better than the Shakespearean sonnet. The glossa sends them on a search to find the perfect four lines from that perfect source poet that really resonates for them. It's personal. I've seen students quote the ghazals of Rumi and Hafiz for their glosses. Students have also quoted Beyonce and Taylor Swift lyrics, which is perfectly legit. The glossa is a kind of music. It's a call and response poem. Inspired by my zealous students, I wrote my own collection of glossa poems over the last year, where the words end and my body begins. So when I started this book, I knew I needed to look well outside of the canon that PK Page drew from, using quotes from Rilke and Thomas, and mostly white men of systemic esteem didn't actually fit with my lived experience. The glossa is personal. It has to resonate with the writer. So I wanted to reflect back on my earliest contact with poetry that I found right here in the downtown East Side, to use poetry as a tool of resistance, to celebrate survival, to honor memory, even tough memories. I wanted to write about sex work justice, anti-colonial violence, overcoming stigma, forgiveness, other themes of social justice. I wanted to blend the grit and the tenacity of my subject matter with this beautiful lyrical form that is the glossa. So I chose poets that would allow me to continue honoring my own memories. Many of the poets I chose are local, so poets that have made really deep investments in this culturally rich city that we live in. Yeah, thank you so much. Lydia Kwa is one of 19 source poets that I quote in my book. She's a clinical psychologist and a writer, and she keeps her counseling practice office on the edge of Chinatown in the downtown East Side. Now, she is a true champion of using creative processes in order to recover from trauma. So here's the quatrain, the four lines that I chose from Lydia Kwa. What makes someone capable of creating a new paradigm and living it? Who owns that willingness to create? And please allow me to read
the poem that I wrote for Lydia in response. What you're going to look at is four sections of 10 lines, and then Lydia's response, Lydia's quotes come in to play every so often. See if you can hear them. Over $5 lattes, a dear old and I reminisce upon our all-time favorite suicide plans. XYZ Pharmacy, I say, buy shady methadone, then head up Hastings to the Second Empire skyscraper. I have a rooftop key. I wonder if you can still score fizzies at XYZ, dear old asks. She makes culture for the city now, me, university, square pegs cobbled into round holes, gray mare whores in a greener graze. Do we miss the glory days? Retrospect blur. I can look back until I see double. What makes one capable of so much change? Hand-to-mouth survival is off the schedule, and it seems I have freed up time for existential questions. Aesthetics fluxed when I realized I'd live. All that beauty that once wanted nothing to do with me is now ubiquitous. Beaumont pink is my newest mentor. Color therapy? Whatever helps us carry on. There are no wrongs. Forgiveness is tactile learning. Touch, movement, sound, repeat. Self-love mastered by mnemonics, the sing-song rhyme of creating a new paradigm. We hear with our ear. Rhythm helps your tender heart move. And the wise old owl, she lived in the oak. The more she saw, the less she spoke. There is a question I still haven't answered in verse. What happened to the others? I lost more than mercury and sweat during detox. Where's my down at the heel line? Come up dreamers, beasties, the pretty brass, those existing by the minute and living it so close to the bone. Where's their microphone? What stage has been erected for the disaffected? What wall to mount a cracked jaw collage? The exhibition hall is narrow space. Think of the minds mislaid in the pinch. Oh, but how loss makes us look for glint and change. One empire's trash is our pièce de résistance. Are you like me? Did you have to see the precise shade of your own spilled blood before you knew what you must do? Then you also know struggle and art making can be the same. Then you also know who owns that willingness to create. So in closing, I want to invite each of you to consider what needs to be created to honor your memories. From distance to life-changing pivotal moments, from traumatic to joyful. Your memories are all you need to become artists. You don't have to write a glossa poem. You don't have to write a poem of all, or even a song. You could cook your memories a grand feast. You could repaint your bedroom a bold new color. You could dance tonight so freely at the Taj Mahal Foxtrot. When memory speaks to you, respond. Create and honor your own remarkable lives. Thank you for your kind attention.
Oh, Amber fucking Dawn. So good. Can we get another round of applause, please? Also give a huge round of applause for Kalyani, who killed it. So talented. Thank you for coming into our lives. When I read Kalyani's bio via email, I literally wept with laughter. Please look her up. She's absurdly talented and has won like a bajillion awards and is so amazing. I mean, you've won awards in my mind, so, you know, that's what counts. And we really, 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 really want to thank her. She's been so wonderful tonight. Please give it up one more time. Thank you for taking the piss out of white people, because usually I have to do that by myself. Thank you for upping the homo contingent, because usually I have to do that by myself. So I appreciate you to the nth degree. For those of you who are joining us for Taj Mahal Foxtrot, I'm really excited. For those of you who are only here for this event, thank you so much for coming. You would do us a great and beautiful favor if you all got the hell out of this room, because we have to empty it out and reconfigure it so that we can make it more accessible for our returning guests and our new guests. So please do me a favor and chat as you walk. I know you can multitask. I believe in you. And thank you so much for coming.